you have Doximity, you know, you're paying for it with the vendor, but that's part of the package deal. A lot of people think maybe the technology is expensive and burdens and hard to navigate, when they're using it. But in essence, what Full Circle provides is you have your laptop. You have your integrated camera in your laptop, and you conduct your session, and then the beauty is you don't have to give up your EHR. Because who wants to give up their EHR? That's terrible. It's just a nightmare. You bill it right through your existing EHR, keep your patient charts, all you do is add the GT modifier, that's it. You are Telepsych 4. Each insurance company has its little quirks regarding Telepsych, and they're different from one to the next. But all in all, we have a lot of CPT codes that are now approved for Telepsych that are being pushed. And the one we kind of talked about, not comparable, having a person-to-person consult, but we also found that Telepsych is just as effective and also provides a level of safety too, if you think about it. You're not sitting in a room anymore with the patient. I've never had a problem like that, but I know providers have. And that's just another layer of padding to have. The other nice piece too, I'll just throw in there, so I'm sure everyone's thinking about it, your revenue. So you have a session, right? At the end of the session, in our platform, we actually have something called Stripe, which it'll charge the patient's credit card. It keeps their credit card locked into their system, so you never see the numbers, right? And updates all the time, always doing checks to make sure that it's not expired. Charges them at the end of the appointment, direct deposit, or if it's a copay, same thing, charges for that, direct deposit, done. That's just a little feature I forgot to mention earlier, but it's good to know. So, what do you do to integrate this stuff? I was talking with Glenda earlier, no one wants to just unload their practice and jump into Telepsych. I didn't. What I suggest is start using it as an adjunct with your current patients. I'm sure everyone here can think of some patients who really don't want to come in on Wednesday at 2 o'clock because they got kids' soccer practice or da 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 da. We all know we snuck in a telephone session here and there because you got to do what you got to do, even though we're not really lucky. So start adjuncting it because the beauty is at this point in time, utilizing Full Circle, all you're tapping into is Zoom, which is just a teleconference. Turns on, and a little email invite goes to your patient. They click that, you're in your session.
Is the appointment that readily available, or do you schedule a time to
meet? Typically, people are going to be scheduling times to meet. It won't be like, here and there kind of thing. My electronic health record system that I've been using for a while is Health Fusion. We also use Valent in the practice.
Which one are you using?
We have a combo. We have Health Fusion and Valent in the practice.
Why do you have both?
Why we have both? Well, the billing component of Health Fusion is awesome. The clinical side of Valent is better. So basically what we do is we pay just for the billing and scheduling portion of Health Fusion, and we pay just for the clinical side of Valent, which actually ends up being the same price and we get a better product. Two EHRs later, now we're slapping on Zoom to do this Telepsych thing. after tonight, I'm like, why don't I just put this all together and, you know, call it full circle, because that just makes sense. And put a lot of other pieces, a lot of other bells and whistles will come down, like data exchange and direct referrals and whatnot. But again, you know, you just utilize your current schedule, and, you know, if you're a 1 o'clock patient, you ping them right beforehand, they accept, and there you have it. And again, double encryption, both sides, HIPAA compliant all the way around. You know, obviously, you can talk to us if you're thinking about it. And to set up your own virtual practice, really not that difficult. You know, it's tougher to do a prior auth than it is to set this thing up. So that's really what we got for right now.
So I have a question. When I work in internal medicine, I want to refer somebody to behavioral health services. So would that referral go through your office, or is there, and then they get the option to tell a psych or tell?
So what's going to happen with full circle is that there's going to be a provider network. Think of like LinkedIn, right? You're going to be able to see psych prescriber section, therapist section, internal medicine, primary care section. Everyone can see each other. Everyone, you know, again, ages taken, insurances, schedule availability, what have you, contact information, and it's going to be provider to provider. So you'll be able to, if you're looking for something for a specific patient, type in those variable points that you need, that you want to refer out to psych, and it's going to make a match. Now this, again, our version one, since data exchange, which is really what we're talking about here, which is just passing, you know, a lot of zeros and ones back and forth, is a bit tough to engineer.
Yeah.
And we are building that component for our next wave. So this, what will happen in version one is that you'll be able to see everybody, and you'll be able to make a phone call, or you could shoot over a message to the provider too. That's a possibility, a direct message. But probably be easier just to make the call. So it really makes for visibility within the network.
So make the call. I'm a little confused. So I wanted to send somebody over, so if I get online and look to see the match for the patient.
Right. You'll be able to get online, see what the match is for the patient. Now, in later versions, we'll be able to just make that direct syndication of a referral and a booked appointment right there between the two EHRs. We're not at that level yet. That is like super complex IT we're talking, but that'll be our next generation. Right now, you can see each other. You can see what the credentials are, the preferences, the specialties, the insurances taken, the ages, but you can't make that direct referral online between the EHRs. You actually are gonna have to call that provider to still make that referral. So right now it's a network that is set up.
So the patient can't call the provider
himself? The provider could call, or the patient could call.
Okay.
It's whatever the preference is. But the information is there, is the point.
But you have to be, but Carol would have to be in the network in order to access your network?
That is correct. If
yeah.
you,
so
if you're accessing
that
network,
so
no, I'm sorry.
She would need to join
your
full circle in order to be able to access that list.
Right. So
provider.
It's just setting up, you know, it's like setting up any profile that you do for marketing. You know, who you are, what you do, what you take, what you see, when you see them.
So you just get yourself on there.
So you get yourself on there, and now you have visibility. Like I said, the next step would be the actual electronic communication, so you don't have to touch phones anymore.
So I have a couple of questions. One is licensure to practice. So we were talking before you had your presentation about when a nurse practitioner wants to see a patient who, say, lives in Massachusetts, or in
So right now there's two terms that are, you know, are in legislature in, you know, all insurances policies. There's the originating site, which means where the patient is at time of service. And there's the distance site, which means where the provider is at time of service. The originating site, where the patient is at time of service, determines where you're actually giving medical services. So if we're in New York and the patient's in Massachusetts, you better have a Massachusetts license if you're going to be rendering that service. But vice versa, like I said before, if the patient's in New York and you happen to be down in Miami, that's fine. You can do that. That's not a problem.
Right. It's where the patient lives that where you need to be licensed.
That's correct.
Right. So then my second question on this is with insurers. So if I'm a New York State Medicaid provider and I want to see a patient in Indiana, can I bill? I can't bill Medicaid. I have to be paneled in Indiana.
That is correct.
Yeah. So when you're doing telepsych, it sounds like you would need to be licensed in multiple states, or at least in, and you would need to be on panels.
If you're going to go the insurance route, yes. Now again, these terms again are very much within the insurance industry. So a lot of people will do, you know, private pay clientele, which is absolutely fine. They could be, you know, across the state line in Massachusetts, and it's a private transaction. If you gotta pay through insurance, that's when it gets really sticky and they don't like that.
But you can be a participating provider if you're gonna be, if you're gonna charge insurance.
Yeah,
so that's where the issues are gonna come. You're gonna have to go private pay. I'm not so sure about the licensure for a nurse practitioner in New York State that you can practice beyond those state lines.
You can't.
You have to have a license in another state.
Correct. I would be very worried about someone who practiced telepsych and private pay. You're still providing medical services to a patient that you are not licensed in that state. Right?
Can I just add something?
Yes.
Where get really muddy is, we live in a population that's often mobile. Many of the patients in my population are snowbirds, for example, and so they go to Florida for 4 months of the year, and they call me and say, I need a renewal on my medication. Well, with telepsychiatry, if they're in Florida, but their legal residence is in New York, how does that work? And I can call in interval prescriptions to Florida, as long as they're not substances, because nurse practitioners in Florida can't issue control substances. So I can see where it would be a little murky.
It can blur.
But you're not actually seeing them, you're just renewing their script.
Yeah, but there are times where people with snowbirds are fine. They'll come in once they have got this, that, and
they need an evaluation.
And I'll call in a prescription because I've already established a relationship with them, the relationship has been established, so I can converse with them no matter where they are,
right.
And continue to render care for them.
Are you billing?
No.
Are you charging them?
No, I'm not charging.
That's what I'm saying.
So that's where the problem, the active charging a patient,
right,
and seeking compensation for your services becomes this trade issue
that
you have to save on.
Right, and there are times, I'm sure, where the patient is just not calling for renewal. Joe has died, and they're depressed, and they're anxious, and, you know, would you consider another medication? And then the need to do a more comprehensive evaluation is present.
I do that a lot. I have a lot of patients, and I don't charge. It's done informally.
It's done pro bono.
Yeah.
What I'm saying.
Yeah.
Push it through, get them covered, get them home.
What was that?
Push the medication through, get them covered for the time being.
Right. Or extend their treatment. I mean, if you've already established a relationship, this is, you know, I think we're talking more about the person that you've never seen before that you